Mouse Jones Davis. If Texas A&M is going to win this basketball game, they are going to crush Kentucky on the glass and pound it inside. Look for Millie Kennedy's team to push in transition, but if they don't have it, punch that thing, try to post up Jones against Derek Willis.
You know, much of this season has been as confusing as Kanye going for a GoFundMe page. The Aggies fell in the ditch trying to climb back out. Here's their opportunity. Dan and Jay with the call from College Station.
Reese, thank you very much. Aggie fans are fired up for the first ever basketball edition of College Game Day to come here to College Station. Welcome to the Infinity College Basketball Tip-Off, and welcome to Reed Arena. It is loud in here right now as A&M gets set to host Kentucky in a game of extreme importance within the SEC standings. Here's why. Kentucky is on top right now at 10-3, a game ahead of LSU, two games ahead of Texas A&M. Kentucky's got a difficult schedule to finish the regular season. A&M can really make some noise if they could win this game here today. Hi, everybody, and welcome. Dan Shulman to Jay Billis. Glad you're with us. Give me a key or two that's going to decide this game.
Well, Kentucky's got an outstanding backcourt with Tyler Ulis and Jamal Murray, and Jamal Murray's been averaging 28 points a game, shooting 57% for free over his last four games. So you know Kentucky's guards are going to score. I think to counteract that for Texas A&M, they've got size, and they've got size with their wings. Daniel House and Jalen Jones are all SEC performers from last year. They haven't played well in the same game in a while, and they're going to have to play really well, and I think they're going to have to attack Derek Willis and make him defend, because Willis hit seven threes in his last game against Tennessee at 25 points. That trio from Kentucky can really score. I think they have to make him guard. Texas A&M does.
For more on today's big matchup, let's bring in Shannon.
Well, Dan, what an environment. The 12th man is here. They are active here tonight. But, you know, Jalen Jones told me today this crowd, this energy, it's something that they, quote, had to earn. In fact, Jones admitted he almost didn't come to Texas A&M because he thought of it as a football school. It was his dad that said to him, just consider the potential. The potential is loud and the potential is clear as this entire crowd is white out tonight here, but they will be tested. Jalen Jones told me, you know, when Kentucky strikes, how we respond, how we stay together, and that will all depend on their veteran leadership.
Shannon, thank you. It is loud here tonight. This has been the Infinity Tip-Off. Now let's see what happens when coaches hit the racetrack for this year's Infinity Coaches Charity Challenge. Welcome to Reed Arena and welcome to Saturday Primetime presented by DirecTV. As you can see and hear and hopefully feel, this place is alive right now. This is a big game for A&M. They started conference play 7-0, but they've lost five of their last six within the league. Now they are coming off a win over Ole Miss, so they're at 8-5, and they're still within striking distance of the top spot of the conference, but they need this game today if they're going to have any shot of winning the SEC regular season championship. The starting lineups for Kentucky: Ulis, Briscoe, Murray, very hot, as Jay mentioned. Derek Willis, as Jay said, coming off a 25-point game against Tennessee Thursday night. Marcus Lee didn't play in the second half against Tennessee because of back spasms, but he is in the starting lineup here tonight for Kentucky. For A&M, a lot of experience on this team. Four seniors. Collins, a fifth-year senior, transferred from USF, and a really good freshman, the big man in the middle, Tyler Davis. Fifth year for Billy Kennedy at the helm of the Aggies has not taken them to the NCAA tournament. This does figure to be the year. They're in a very good position right now. They'd like to even improve upon that. John Calipari in his seventh season as the head coach of Kentucky, and you can see his list of accomplishments during his tenure in Lexington. Big Blue always gets the other team's best shot when they go on the road, and Big Blue Jay, as you know, they travel pretty well. And there are several hundred Kentucky fans who have found their way into this building here today.
They find their way into every building. I wouldn't be surprised if they bought season tickets a few years ago just for this one.
Texas A&M controls the opening tip. Matt Adams, Anthony Jordan, Jerry Pollard, our officials today.
Well, Kentucky starts man-to-man, and Jamal Murray on Alex Caruso. Caruso is an excellent ball handler and passer and steals guy. He's another point guard on the floor with Collins.
He is A&M's all-time leader in steals, second in assists. Jalen Jones strong inside. Follow no good. And the loose rebound down to Tyler Ulis. Ahead to Jamal Murray. Little shovel pass off to Briscoe. Murray better than 28 points per game in his last four. And Ulis has had some spectacular games recently. That duo now about as good as any combination in the country.
Well, Caruso guarding Jamal Murray. Caruso, an excellent individual defender, and he's got length.
Marcus Lee to the left hand, won't go.
Well, Kentucky needs some production out of its big guys. Whether it's Marcus Lee or Scalabissiere coming off the bench, they've got to get some points from the middle.
Davis had a gimme at the rim, can't finish, but he does run down the rebound. Daniel House around and out. And the rebound to Willis of Kentucky.
Transition defense against Kentucky, very important, and you got to find that guy first, number 23, Jamal Murray. And Caruso did a good job with them. You have to corral and contain Ulis and find Murray.
Still looking to break the seal in this one, better than a minute and a half in.
Isaiah Briscoe looks like he's playing in the 80s.
Foul on Collins with the short shorts.
Yeah, he's rolled up. He's rolled up his shorts, and he looks like Kenny Walker. No, he rolled him up from the waistband. Turn that waistband over. It's white. The rest of them are blue. Throwback.
A foul on Collins. It'll be Kentucky ball underneath the basket of Murray to inbound.
Jalen Jones guarding Derek Willis, and Willis, his insertion into the starting lineup has really changed this Kentucky team. You can't just sit in the lane against him now and pack it in. You've got to respect his three-point shooting ability, and that's opened things up for some drives, and it's also opened up for Jamal Murray to go crazy.
Averaging about 12 points per game as a starter, Willis is, including 25 Thursday night against Tennessee. Quick turnaround for Kentucky, playing less than 48 hours later. Murray, good D by Caruso. Willis from the wing, around and out. And the rebound down to House.
Well, Texas A&M has good size on the wings. Both Jones and House, they have size, they're athletic.
Jones over Willis, no.
A&M's had some opportunities on the glass. I think they can get some offensive rebounds, especially Tyler Davis.
Ulis whips a pass to Willis, now to Briscoe. Briscoe will do what he does best, which is drive. The follow for Marcus Lee, and finally, somebody scores in this one.
It looked like Briscoe just cleared everybody out on that drive, and it was wide open for Marcus Lee to get to the offensive board. That's what he does. He's one of the best offensive rebounders in the SEC.
He's given up a lot of bulk in the matchup with Tyler Davis at this end of the court.
Tyler Davis is such a big, strong player. Billy Kennedy said he reminds him of a Sean May type. Leads the nation in perspiration. He works so hard. The guys, nobody sweats more than he does.
Jalen Jones for three.
Well, Jalen Jones is an energy guy, but he's so athletic. When he drives it, when he's kind of a junkyard dog, that's when he's at his best. And then he adds a perimeter shot in there. When he's looking for his perimeter shot first, he's not quite as effective.
Both he and Daniel House averaging better than 15 a game. Jamal Murray, whose season average is up over 19 a game with his hot streak, puts Kentucky back on top.
Well, he is so good, and I think people expected that from the get-go.
Jones stepping into another one.
Well, you can tell Texas A&M much more confident at home than on the road.
Ulis the lob and Lee the finish.
Anytime that Kentucky penetrates, they're not going to throw a bounce pass. They're throwing that thing up to the rim. It's going to be a lob. You ever see a bounce pass by a guard in the lane? They're coming out.
Caruso misses the three. And it will be Kentucky ball when we come back. And when we come back, Coach Calipari will visit with Coach Greenberg right beside the Kentucky bench.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Welcome back to College Station, where the Kentucky Wildcats and Texas A&M tied up at six. Jalen Jones has knocked down back-to-back threes while Kentucky's been attacking the basket. Euless dropped the dime over the top. Lee got an easy one. I'm interested to see if John Calipari feels he needs to make any changes defensively with Jones getting those two threes. Cal, first 4 minutes. Any adjustments? What you feel for the game?
Well, I'm not sure Jamal's going to beat a kid, beat Caruso on the bounce, so we want to throw him into some ball screens possibly, because I saw what happened there. But this game's going to unfold. They haven't seen us. We haven't seen them all year. We're just trying to figure out what's the best way to go.
Great, thanks.
So an early compliment from John Calipari on the defense of Alex Caruso. Caruso's an excellent defender. You know, he's the all-time steals leader here at Texas A&M. But he also plays good fundamental defense. He stays in front, and he's going to force you to do something good to beat him.
Wow, Jones is feeling it. His third three, he's got all nine for the Aggies.
I'm not sure on the scouting report that it said, watch out for Jalen Jones to pull up by the M in Texas A&M, but he just about did that.
Wow. Caruso hounding Murray, Collins on Euless. Euless had it knocked away. Jones comes up with a loose ball, and he gave it right back. But Isaac Humphries, the freshman from Australia, who just checked in, gathered it and then took a step into the backcourt. John Calipari not sure about the validity of that call.
Well, it's just a question of whether he had possession. I don't think he had possession.
That's what John Calipari is saying. So Humphries getting a chance, Jay, to play more the last four or five games because Alex Poitras is still out. Fifth consecutive game that he's missing with a bad right knee.
Well, he just gives Kentucky a really big body that's very skilled. He's just incredibly young. He's only 18 years old. Yeah, they don't have to worry about him going in the draft because he's not old enough.
Tavario Miller, junior from the Bahamas, number 42 for A&M into the game for the first time for the Aggies.
Texas A&M likes to set a lot of ball screens. They're step-up, side ball screens, and they do a really good job off that action.
House Snow, the rebound tipped down to Humphries.
In transition, you're going to have different matchups. Now got a switch, and Humphries was wide open, and Murray missed him. Now going into their elbow series.
Lee the handoff to Euless, shot clock inside 10. Murray off the screen, Caruso right up on him. Shot clock down to three.
And made him pick up his dribble. How good was that defensively? That wide pin down, and Alex Caruso stayed right with them until he caught it. And Jalen Jones has started off really well. Set the little screen and then spotted up to the three-point line. Then as the trailer in transition, knocking it down, and that wasn't far enough. So he decided to back out a little bit more. I guess that would be called a heat check. And, you know, he's the subject of our 94 feet this week, and I got to tell you, I think we know how to pick them.
The guys who you've chosen for 94 feet have gone on to have good games.
Yeah, Bryce Johnson last week. Yeah. He had, what, 29 points in the first 30 minutes. Yeah. Had a pretty darn good game against Miami today.
They shredded the Hurricanes today. 96-71, and it was about, at one point I saw it was a 38-point margin, wound up at 25.
North Carolina's capable of that. I think they're the best team in the country, but they have to play that way.
Murray misses the three. And who's the foul on? Humphries? Yeah, it's on Humphries of Kentucky.
Tavario Miller with a nice block out. Humphries has size, but he's also a very skilled player. He's got every shot, and as Shannon Spake found out in that terrific feature she did on SportsCenter, an excellent piano player.
Can sing too, right?
Apparently.
Adamon Gilder in off the bench now for A&M, freshman from Dallas.
Gilder? A lot of Princess Bride references with this guy.
We wore that out in the Bahamas in November when we saw the Aggies. House into traffic. Humphries got a piece, and it's out of bounds. You got some better information on Gilder today, though.
Yeah, apparently Gilder is the most photographed Aggie by himself. He takes a lot of pictures of himself, and a source very close to the program said he is the basically, what did they call him? Like the photo queen of the
team? Something like that, yeah. He lists his
hobby. The beauty queen. They call him the beauty queen.
He lists his hobby in the media guide as sleeping, which we debated whether or not that's actually a hobby.
But and eating.
And eating. I'm sorry, eating. You're right. But they avoid the shot clock violation, but Humphries has the rebound. But apparently taking selfies should be his number one hobby from what we've heard.
Well, eating's one of my hobbies.
Briscoe the kick. Dominique Hawkins knocks down the three.
But just like you did against Louisville, Dominique Hawkins has not logged a ton of time. He's had some injury here and there, but tell you what, he was great when he came in against Louisville.
Daniel House has lost a shoe. He's still in the backcourt putting it on and now tying it up. And Collins is trying to buy some time so they can play 5-on-5.
I still don't understand how you can lose a high top. That just means it's a high top shoe. It just means you haven't tied it. Good pass.
Miller can't finish over Humphreys. And it'll be a held ball situation. It'll belong to Kentucky.
Boy, that was an excellent dive forward by Isaiah Briscoe. I thought he got the first down.
Well, maybe Von Miller can help us. Super Bowl MVP, a former Aggies in the house here today. There's Von Miller. A proud Aggie.
I don't think he's gotten his Super Bowl ring yet. How quickly do they churn those things out?
Is the ovation here as they put his picture up on the videos board above us.
But how fast were the Broncos getting to Cam Newton? It was absolutely remarkable.
Tied at 9. Jalen Jones is the only Aggie to score. He's got 3 threes. He's on the bench right now. Briscoe left the jumper way short. He is a great driver, but he is really having trouble making jump shots, to say the least.
Well, that's 17 threes in a row that he's missed. The last three he hit was against Arizona State on December the 12th.
Humphreys giving Kentucky some good work on the glass right now.
He's going to be a really good player. He's got a lot of ability, just young.
Briscoe here in the air ball champ.
Well, with Caruso out, now Anthony Collins, a fifth-year senior from Houston who played at South Florida, took them to the NCAA tournament. He's the only player on this team that's got NCAA tournament experience.
Ulis puts Kentucky back on top.
Winning games, that is.
Tyler Ulis, better than 16 points and a conference-leading 6.8 assists per game. What an outstanding year the sophomore is having.
Even better in conference play. He's averaging about 20 in the SEC.
And great leadership, intangibles, the whole package.
That's the thing. I mean, he's proven to be not only one of a handful of the best point guards. I think it's between him and Chris Dunn for the nation's best point guard.
An A&M turnover. 2-point lead for Kentucky. When we come back to Reed Arena, Jay Billis goes 94 feet with Jalen Jones.
Hope I make it.
Feet with Texas A&M's Jalen Jones. Where did you grow up?
I was actually an Army brat. Grew up a little bit of everywhere, Georgia, Alaska, lived in Texas as well.
What's your pregame routine?
Usually just listen to some music, R&B, hip-hop, whatever gets me going.
What do you listen to?
Drake, Lil Wayne, Usher.
When's the first time you dunked a basketball?
It actually was in middle school towards the end of my 8th grade year.
How about your favorite TV show?
Smart Guys at Disney Channel.
94 feet.
Well done. When's the first time you dunked a basketball?
I'm still waiting.
Let's check in with Shannon Spade.
Well, Dan, he was really hyped coming into this game. It's actually the first time he's ever played against Kentucky. He was injured last year when A&M played Kentucky. He said, listen, I approach each game and each opponent the same way, but I have an opportunity to make a statement here tonight.
Well, he has made 3 early statements with threes. He's the only Aggie to score. It is 11-9 Kentucky. Jones on the bench, Caruso on the bench as well, Murray on the bench for Kentucky. Ulis leans in, forced it up. Down with the rebound is DJ Hogue, the freshman from Plano, Texas, 6'8 guy with a good stroke.
Kentucky was trying to run Jamal Murray off a little baseline screen. It's kind of a floppy set that they run. And Caruso just is glued to him, not giving him any room at all, staying on that outside shoulder and chasing him out of the three-point line.
Hogue for 3. The first Aggie other than Jones to score. They go back on top. And forgive me, after that last time out, both Caruso and Murray both checked back into the game. Do you get the feeling whenever Murray goes in or out, Caruso's going to do the same thing today?
Well, if Caruso, the way he's guarded him early on, you want to keep him on him because Alex never gets tired, and he is a really smart defender. Got beat there, and that you give him a little bit of room. That was kind of a Reggie Miller move, going from one side of the court to the other. Got a little bit of separation. That's all that Jamal Murray needs to catch and shoot, a little bit of separation.
Last 4 games coming into this one, Murray 21 for 37 from three-point range.
That's ridiculous when you're unguarded.
Caruso, nice pass off to Gilder. Caruso from the corner can't make the three. And the weak side rebound to Gilder. Hogue, a deep one. Got it! Every point they've got has been on a three-pointer.
Well, Hogue's a big-time shooter, just a freshman. He and Tyler Davis were teammates in high school. And Hogue is going to be a great play. He's had some back problems. He's actually wearing a back, has been wearing a back brace in practice. I don't know if he's got it on now, but you give him any room, he's another guy. When he sees a big basket, forget him.
Murray. And he'll answer with a three of his own. Kentucky back on top.
Alex Caruso cannot help off of Jamal Murray. You know, you're trained to help when there's penetration, but you can't do it off of Murray. You got to stay glued to him.
And we were at practice yesterday and shoot around today, and you know as well as I do, better than I do, that was emphasized in practice. You cannot help off him.
Well, you don't want any closeouts to Jamal Murray because he's such a great shooter. And you can see right here, gonna help in, and once you help in, that's too far a distance to cover. And Murray, by the time you get there, he's already into a shooting motion and up. And there's no way he's missing those. He's just too good of a player. And he's as confident now as perhaps he's ever been. I think, Dan, you know him. He's a Canadian kid.
We all know each other.
Earlier on in the season, yeah, it doesn't have been in Canada. Yeah. But early on in the season, I think he was a little bit confused by the dribble drive stuff and how he fit in with it. But boy, he's figured it out. John Calipari's changed his system a bit to have him coming off of screens instead of the dribble drive stuff, as much of it anyway. And he's really adjusted nicely.
Kitchener, Ontario, about an hour west of Toronto, reclassified to get into this class, like Jay meditates before every game. And he is really, really finding his way. 28 points per game the last four. Is he playing himself into SEC Player of the Year consideration?
I think he's up there, but I would put Ben Simmons and Tyler Ulis in a dead heat right now. And Ulis, I give the nod to Ulis because his team wins more. And I think when you start giving out Player of the Year awards, winning is a huge consideration.
Kentucky will finish the regular season 5th of March at home to LSU, a game that conceivably could decide the regular season championship. Good follow by Caruso.
Well, how about Caruso going into the body of Humphreys, and Humphreys got knocked back, and Caruso's strong enough to go back for that second effort. He didn't get knocked off balance by that strong drive.
First two-point field goal of the game for A&M.
Does it drive you crazy when it says, like, Ontario, Canada instead of Kitchener, Ontario? That's like saying from North Carolina, United
USA,
States.
Yes. Another conversation for another time.
It's always good to talk about Canada. Good pass.
Ulis, a deep three. Humphreys battling, but it's Davis who wins the battle for the rebound.
Boy, that was a man's rebound. That looked like it was going to Humphreys, and Davis just took it right away.
Caruso, nice bounce pass into Davis. Counted and a foul.
That is just beautiful basketball. The ball screen and hard roll to the basket and a beautiful pocket pass between two defenders. How about that play from the big guy from Plano?
Timeout on the floor. Seth Greenberg, Billy Kennedy when we come back to Reed Arena.
This is the SEC on ESPN, and Texas A&M opened up the game with five straight threes. They've been able to get it inside the last few possessions. Billy, are you happy with the pace of the game?
What's that?
You happy with the pace of the game?
I wish we would slow down offensively, but I like the pace being fast, but we got to make better decisions on the offense.
Murray knocked down a couple of threes. Any changes in how you're going to guard him?
No, tough shots. You know, he's going to make some. We can't help as much off on that left. But our ball screen defense, Caruso had to help.
Great, thanks, man.
And just as you were saying, Caruso helped off. Just kind of the thing your brain tells you to do. You've been doing it forever, but you can't do it in this situation.
Yeah, that's the hard part about you're trained a certain way and drilled to do things a certain way, and then you have to switch it up. And really, that's what the three-point line does. It's an asymmetrical threat that you have to deal with. You have to take away the shot, and then your coaches expect you to take away the drive, too. And you're playing against, oftentimes, like Jamal Murray's a great player. He's not a good player. He's a great player.
Scalabissier into the game for Kentucky. Passed up the mid-range jumper. Now the floater from Ulis is short. And out ahead of the pack is Gilder, being chased by a couple of Wildcats. And he'll split between them and lay it in.
Well, I thought Gilder had slowed down too much. I thought he should have just busted it to the rim. But he's so strong, he was able to almost create that contact and then go through it. Back to the elbow series now for Kentucky. Wide pin down for Briscoe, and you know he's not going to shoot it. He's going to try to get to the rim.
Ulis will shoot it. The assist to Murray, and Kentucky back within two.
And Ulis coming off a difficult shooting game. He went 3 of 15 in his last ball game against Tennessee. And you know, before the game, some of our people noticed he was favoring his right wrist, and it looked like it was bothering him. Didn't look like it was bothering him on that last play.
Caruso the drive, kick to the wing.
Good fake.
Gilder the floater. And Trocia Morelos with a rebound and a fresh 30. Ho has already hit a couple of threes, and now Davis over the back called for the foul. Now this week on Big Monday, great action continues. Malcolm Brogdon, number 7 of Virginia, taking on to Miami. Miami got roughed up by North Carolina today. We'll see how they respond. And then it's into Big 12 country, Iowa State against West Virginia. West Virginia a loser at home to Oklahoma earlier today. Speaking of Virginia and speaking of North Carolina, that's who we'll see 1 week from today for game day down in Charlottesville.
Well, North Carolina couldn't have looked any better against Miami today in the Smith Center. And then Virginia is starting to play like Virginia again. And Malcolm Brogdon, I think, making a great case for ACC Player of the Year. I think he'll most certainly be ACC Defensive Player of the Year.
Lee, Briscoe, LaBissiere with the 18-footer. He can make that shot consistently. Have you seen signs over the last 4 or 5 games that he's starting to develop, starting to improve?
Yeah, he's starting to get better. But I think the main thing, he's got to get a lot stronger. He's got to rebound. Right now, he speaks more languages than he averages rebounds, and that's just not going to work unless he learns 9 more languages.
Jones, 3 early threes, and now the mid-range jumper. The Aggies back on top.
Oh, what an athlete. He has game-changing athleticism and some switching out front. Now Jones on Ulis. Good pass.
Briscoe with his first three, as Jay mentioned earlier, since the 12th of December against Arizona State.
John Calipari was giving him a hard time yesterday in practice about a little curl move they had off an out-of-bounds under, and he says, well, you can't make that shot. Make it. Come on, make it. And then he made the next one. But here he is spotting up, and there you can tell that Texas A&M doesn't respect his perimeter shot. Maybe it was the 80s garb he's wearing.
He's dressed like when they were playing before the three-point line existed.
He's dressed like Kyle Macy right now. Looks like Roger Harden.
He's now 5 for 32 from three-point range on the season. And the A&M staff said if he makes one or two of them, you tip your cap. They want to play him as a driver, which is what he's best at. Let's check in with Shannon.
You know, Dan, last week John Calipari said his team took ownership of the team after he was ejected at South Carolina. I've been watching him, and while he's standing up right now pleading his case, he has been sitting down the majority of this game. Yeah, he'll stand up and make substitutions, but then he immediately goes back to his seat. He's just letting these guys lead the team. He told me earlier today, us coaches were along for the ride.
You have to figure that Tyler Ulis has a lot to do with that, the leadership that they have from the point guard position in Ulis. But John Calipari, more than any other coach in America, has a brand new team every year. And it's a process every year, as talented as they may be in any given year, for him to really figure out what they've got.
Yeah, and John and the staff have done a really good job with this team. But, if they're just along for the ride, he is doing an awful lot of backseat driving.
Another offensive rebound for the Aggies.
And that's really going to be an issue going forward with the big guys for Kentucky. They've got to be, Tony Trocia Morelos, who's an excellent three-point shooter for a big guy. Didn't do much last year, but has really improved. But you give teams extra possessions. That's where the big guys have to be stronger and be more productive. They may not give you scoring, but they've got to give you rim protection and defensive rebounding out of the gate.
Murray being guarded now by Gilder. Now a switch, and Jones is on him.
Got to drive this.
He will. Leans in. Can't finish.
Well, Texas A&M doing a good job of making Kentucky shoot tough shots without fouling them. Those are tough twos, and you'd rather have Jamal Murray driving it, taking a tough two, than taking a three.
How about the move by Anthony Collins?
Yeah.
Anthony Collins, a fifth-year senior, and boy, can he get to the rack. Didn't even need two hands.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's, proud sponsor of the 2016 John R. Wooden Award Men's Player of the Year, and Straight Talk Wireless. Best phones, best networks, half the cost.
Hi, Doug, thank you. Well, if Kansas wins that game, they will be two games up in the Big 12, four games remaining, and in great position, Jay, to win at least a share of the Big 12 regular season championship for the 12th year in a row.
One of the amazing accomplishments in all of college sports, in my judgment, and their home record is ridiculous. It's beyond absurd. I'll tell you what, Kentucky, Big Blue, had better start defensive rebounding because they're giving up. They've given up 12 offensive rebounds in this game and 9 second chance points. That's been the difference in the game. It's 12-1 wow. in offensive rebounds.
Doug Kazarian mentioned that LSU-Tennessee game. Right now, bracketology, Joey Brackets has LSU as an 11 seed. By the way, he's got Kentucky as a 4, A&M as a 6. A&M's got a lot of quality wins. They have kind of fallen on times recently until the win over Ole Miss in their last game, as a travel is called on Gilder. He's also got Alabama, who had won 5 in a row before they were beaten today by Mississippi State. He's got Alabama as the last team in right now, and Vandy is one of the first 4 out. So for teams like LSU, Alabama, Vandy, a lot going to be decided in the next couple of weeks.
Jalen Jones on Derek Willis. He has not gotten an open touch in this ball game.
Anthony Collins did not like the foul call. He is whistled, and Ulis will shoot a couple. Ulis comes up, looks like favoring that right arm a little bit.
Anthony Collins saying that the contact was created by Ulis. And he's right. He's right. That was just a bad call. But you needed to go to replay to see it.
So Ulis at the line for Kentucky, misses the first. He was ESPN.com's National Player of the Week last week. Get a load of these numbers in the games against Georgia and South Carolina. 41 points, 20 assists, and 1 turnover. That's a pretty good week.
You know, his numbers compare so favorably to John Wall when he was a freshman in 2010, except he doesn't turn the ball over nearly as much. Wall turns it over about 4 times per game. But, boy, how good has John Wall gotten in the NBA? And I watched him put 41-10 up on the Golden State Warriors in Washington. And you know, his maturity level, not only as a player, but as a person, is just off the charts.
Some pressure from Kentucky. A&M gets it over. Inside 3 minutes to go in a very competitive first half here at Reed Arena.
Well, I like the full court pressure by Kentucky because they don't have to guard as long in the half court.
Gilder right into the chest of Lee, and Lee down with a rebound.
That really, I think the full court pressure there really disrupted.
Gilder called for the foul. Boy, when Ulis kind of puts his head down, decides he wants to get somewhere, he's going to draw some fouls. And Billy Kennedy, if you can read lips, says that's unbelievable. He doesn't like either call.
I'm not sure whether it wasn't that left arm that got in front of his body there that got called. There's a little hesitation move. It might have been the arm more than anything because he moved his feet and stayed in front. But that's when you're isolated like that and out of the crowd, the referees call that almost every time. If you're in a crowd, you know, there are muggings that can go on.
Ulis to Murray. Murray the drive, jumper over Caruso, not there, and skying for the rebound is Jones.
That was really good help by DJ Hogue there. Coming off his man into the lane because he's not as worried about a perimeter shot from Isaiah Briscoe. Even though Briscoe made his first one since December, that really stopped that drive or slowed it down by Jamal Murray.
Gilder into Davis. Davis back out to Gilder. Good ball movement. Jones misses the three. Davis clears out some space, but Lee rejects it.
And these offensive rebounds are just giving too many extra possessions to Texas A&M. The first shot defense for Kentucky's been pretty good, but just the second and third.
How about DJ Hogue? Some quality minutes off the bench for the freshman. He's already got 8.
Well, he's a quality player, and he's only going to get better as he learns to find more shots and hunt his shot. Anytime he shoots it, he's one of those guys you think it's going in. He's got a high, quick release. Just a beautiful stroke.
And 6'8", too.
Yeah, he's got everything. Look how far he's playing off of Briscoe. He's basically one big help defender.
Euless, a step back three is good.
How do you tell a guy, what do you say? Admon, stay with him. You know, what a great step back. He'd be all over him. He does that quick step back.
It's like telling the Coyote to stay with the Roadrunner. Just can't be done.
Oh, the 16-ton weight you can do.
I believe, though, that's a foul in basketball. Euless with 11 in this game already. Kentucky is 6 for 10 from three-point range. Euless out for a breather. Hawkins back in.
But in that 6 for 10, there's really only one that wasn't expected, and that's the one by Isaiah Briscoe.
Yeah. Derek Willis hasn't made any. He has not scored, coming off that 25-point game against Tennessee Thursday. And he was a big focal point of the Texas A&M shoot-around today.
Referee's making sure that everyone's sitting down because can't have the bench standing up unless it's Monmouth and they can do whatever they want.
Jones off the inbounds.
Another offensive rebound.
Davis. And a foul. No basket, but Davis will head to the free throw line as A&M continuing to demolish Kentucky on the glass.
Davis just pushed Jamal Murray right under the basket, and there was nothing Murray could do about it. I mean, just a little lob, and he went right over the top of him and took it away. And then Murray gave him an angle to the basket instead of staying between Davis and the bucket.
A little cut on the arm of Davis, but they'll play on. That is now 15 offensive rebounds for Texas A&M in the first half to 1 for Kentucky.
I'm not sure I've ever seen a Kentucky team give up 15 offensive rebounds in a half. I think you'd have to go back a ways for that to have happened.
Now, Lee's a great offensive rebounder, but doesn't have the bulk sometimes to protect the defensive glass as well as some bigger guys. Humphreys did a pretty good job when he was in there earlier. Willis is not a big burly guy. LeBissiere's not a burly guy, not a rebounder.
They may not be big burly guys. They can rebound better than this. Yeah. And, you know, Anthony Davis wasn't a big burly guy either. Yeah, he grabbed a lot of rebounds. And, you know, I think getting stronger, LeBissiere is one guy that's got to get stronger, but Lee's a junior. You know, you can't get pushed around when you've been around that long.
Final minute of the first half, 1-point lead, Aggies.
And that's coming from a guy who got pushed around for four straight years.
Good Briscoe, what a move.
He's such a good finisher around the basket. And that's when you know he's going to drive and he can still do it. Foul.
Caruso with a chance for a three-point play.
Well, you just have to pick up the ball in transition, and Kentucky has to work so hard to get that score by Briscoe. And then nobody picks up the ball. Just drove right at Marcus Lee. And Lee's trying to guard Tavario Miller and then protect the rim at the same time. But no guard picked up. I mean, that's got to be either Murray or Briscoe. And they didn't do it.
Caruso, a senior from right here in College Station, was an Aggie ball boy when he was a kid. Reached the 1,000-point plateau in his last game. Known more for his steals, his defense, his passing. But, I mean, he's a terrific all-around basketball
player. Terrific player. He's already the all-time steals leader here at A&M, and he's going to be the assist leader before he's all done. Good steal.
Coming up after us tonight, got some NBA action for you. It'll be the Clippers. Aggies fans, remember DeAndre Jordan well. Taking on the Warriors, who got housed last night by Portland. Damian Lillard scored 51 on Golden State last night. They beat him by 30 plus. We'll see how they respond against Chris Paul, DeAndre Jordan, and the Clippers tonight at the Staples Center.
But for Texas A&M, after they guard this, they got to get the ball down the court quickly. There'll still be some time.
Corner three, Derek Willis, Kentucky by one. Four seconds. House, 25-footer. And the first half comes to a close. Close as expected. Kentucky leading Texas A&M by one, 36-35. Let's go to Shannon.
Thanks so much. Coach, what do you want to see your defense do to start winning the rebound battle?
We don't rebound the ball and we will not win the game. Fight. Before the ball hits the rim, fight for position. If we rebound, we'll be in good shape. If you don't rebound and they get four, they got 10 offensive rebounds. 12. Can't win a game that way. We're lucky we're up one.
Thanks, Coach.
Shannon, don't tell him they had 15. Good thing he walked away before he found that out. Jeep halftime report. Ben Simmons didn't start today for LSU. Buddy Hield, 29 in a win over West Virginia, and a preview of the Warriors and Clippers tonight. Good game here at Reed Arena. 1-point lead for Kentucky over A&M. The Jeep halftime report. Reese, the coach, and Jay Will coming up when we come back. Welcome back to Saturday Primetime, presented by DirecTV. And welcome back to Reed Arena here in College Station, Texas, the home of the Aggies. A good one. Kentucky 36, A&M 35. Going to the second half. Dan Shulman, Jay Billis. You look at the stats, it's pretty basic. Each team is doing one thing really, really well.
Well, they're shooting the three really well. But for Texas A&M, I think they defended pretty well overall. They just have to chase Kentucky off the three-point line, especially Jamal Murray and Tyler Ulis. And they've got to be more precise on the offensive end. They shot just 33%. They got a bunch of extra possessions with all those offensive rebounds. But you got to expect that Kentucky's going to do a better job on the defensive glass in this half. I think Texas A&M's got to finish more plays. You heard Billy Kennedy say slow down a little bit, because I think they've run through some opportunities they've had. And they've got a great opportunity in this game. They need to take advantage of it, because Kentucky is going to play better than they did in the first half.
Moments ago, Shannon spoke with Billy Kennedy.
Thanks so much. Coach, what do you like most about the way that your guys played that first half?
I thought defensively we did some good things. The mistakes we made, they hit big shots, you know, and they're a good team. But offensively, our ball movement needs to get better. We can't settle for threes. We got to drive the ball more and be more aggressive, taking the ball to the basket.
Be more aggressive. I mean, you guys won the offensive battle, the offensive glass battle. What did you like about that?
We got to finish, though. We got to be productive when we're aggressive, and I think we'll be that this half.
Thanks, Coach.
15 offensive rebounds, 12 second chance points in the first half for the Aggies. You got to like them going right inside to Tyler Davis to start the second half. Davis now commits a foul on Murray at the other end.
Well, Tyler Davis can be a force down low, and immediately they went down to him to establish something in the paint. And this is an excellent offensive team that I thought they just weren't as precise in the first half. You heard Billy Kennedy talk about finishing plays. They can't rely on offensive rebounds for a full 40 minutes, because Kentucky's going to shore that up.
From moments ago with Shannon to completely live Shannon.
Well, Dan, Howe spent some time in the locker room at the end of the first half. You could see over his left eye, he has some tape. He did get a cut. He walked by me on his way out to the court. There is a little bit of swelling, so keep your eye on that.
All right, Shannon, thank you. House scoreless in the first half, played 10 minutes, a better than 15-point a game performer for the Aggies. We talked about he and Jones as a pair of forwards or wings or whatever you want to call them. They are two terrific players.
Well, because they're so athletic, and House can shoot it, and he can rise up and shoot over. Now he's got Tyler Ulis on him. Collins stays so low to the ground. It's really amazing how low he gets. He played at South Florida, played in the Big East. And there wasn't a player that I saw during his time in the Big East that could be lower to the ground off the dribble than Anthony Collins.
He is third among all active NCAA players in assists, closing in on 700 in his career. Grad transfer here to A&M. House kicks it out to Jones.
Well, Jones should have been prepared to drive that.
Caruso, and it's off the leg of a Kentucky player, out of bounds to A&M.
Well, one of the things when the ball has kicked to you on a throwback, you've got to be ready to shoot. And if you catch it ready to shoot, you'll be ready to drive. And one of the few times in this game that Jalen Jones hasn't been ready off the catch.
He made three threes in the first half. And miscommunication between Caruso and Collins results in a turnover.
Well, if you go backdoor, you got to go. You can't fake going backdoor because he faked out his own guy. Once you decide to go backdoor, you have to go. If you fake, then it's a turnover.
Kentucky 10-3 in the SEC. A&M is 8-5. LSU trailing right now in their game at Tennessee. If they lose, they'll drop to 9-5. South Carolina with a big win over Florida today, So the Gamecocks are 9-5. A lot up for grabs in the SEC. Jones was prepared to drive on that play.
Well, they've got to drive Derek Willis at every opportunity. One, to make him guard, but two, because that's a difficult matchup for him off the dribble. But I like the 2-2-1 three-quarter court pressure by Kentucky because it takes time off the clock. They've only got a guard for 18, 19 seconds instead of 25.
Kentucky coming in playing very well. They've won their last four by an average of better than 22 points per game, and that guy is one of the reasons why. The finger roll there for Jamal Murray.
He's just a big-time player. You got to respect his shot, and he can also drive it. He's really a point guard out there that's got extraordinary scoring ability. Good pass.
They saw the mismatch. Ulis got caught on a switch on Davis.
And Davis will learn to just take that up when he's got that kind of advantage. Just a one-on-one move right here by Jamal Murray. Come over a little bit late with the help. Collins has got to be there a little bit early. Just took his eye off his help responsibility to see his man and not looking at the ball.
John Calipari takes Derek Willis out of the game as House misses the three. Another offensive rebound by Davis. That's his seventh offensive rebound of the game. But again, as Billy Kennedy said, they've got to be more productive turning those offensive rebounds into points.
Yeah, he looked like he was going up for the dunk instead of just going up strong to finish the play. But his effort, you cannot question it. Tyler Davis just goes after it. Got that ball with two hands, and he should have just powered up instead of trying to dunk it because he opened up to the defense instead of staying his shoulders square to the basket. I think he could have gotten fouled and finished the play rather than missing it altogether. Got a switch here. Ulis needs to drive this.
Briscoe baseline with the reverse. Kentucky by three.
Oh, he is so good on the baseline. Texas A&M wants to force away from the baseline back into help.
House will tie it.
He only needs one eye to make that.
Well, we had a chance to see A&M way back in November in the battle for Atlantis. They lost in the final to Syracuse as Lee slams it home. And Daniel House was terrific in that tournament and has really had a great year. Second time today we've seen the Ulis Lee combo on the alley-oop. 4-3 of the game for Jalen Jones.
And with Texas A&M's defense, I don't think they can continue to switch out on some of these ball screens. You're getting Tyler Davis guarding Ulis, and that's not a good situation for Texas A&M.
Briscoe misses the jumper but gets the rebound. Well, the ball is on a string when it's in the hands of Tyler Ulis.
On the last possession when Ulis drove on Tyler Davis, that's an example of any time they drive, they're just throwing that thing up to the rim.
Left-handed lay-in by Briscoe, and the lead trades hands again.
Hey, Briscoe, you know he's going to drive, and he still gets to the rim. He's just a tough player.
Collins, no. Davis, yes.
Now that's much better for Tyler Davis because he stayed square to the rim and the backboard. Not only did he finish the play, he's got an end one coming.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Wendy's. Proud sponsor of the 2016 John R. Wooden Award Men's Player of the Year. And Buick, proud partner of the NCAA.
Well, welcome back to College Station right here in the huddle with Kentucky. John Calipari just looked at all of his bigs. He pointed at each and every one of them, and he said, do you want to win this game? Do you want to win this game? He said, we have to rebound or we're not going to win this game. He also wants to see the guards get involved in that rebounding and be more active on that transition defense, Dan.
All right, Shannon, thank you. Yeah, the problem that Kentucky had in the first half has continued here in the second half. They've now allowed 17 offensive rebounds. Tyler Davis, who's at the free throw line, is responsible for 8 offensive rebounds all by himself. What's keeping Kentucky in the game? Good three-point shooting, although they haven't even attempted one here in the second half. 7-for-11 from three, all of that coming in the first half.
Well, Texas A&M shooting 62% in the second half, 5-of-8. And Kentucky 4-of-6 from the field. So you give up these extra possessions and it just takes the heart out of your defense. You play good defense for 30 seconds and you give up a second shot.
What's been impressive in this game is how few turnovers there have been. A&M have only committed 3 turnovers in the game. Kentucky has only committed 1 turnover in the game.
Tyler Ulis working off the ball more as a scorer. And Anthony Collins trying to chase him around. You got to chase him off the 3-point line too.
They're going to give Briscoe the jump shot. He made a 3 in the first half. He's made some layups, but he's missed all of his 2-point jumpers. Ulis knocks down a 3, and Kentucky is back on top.
A little turnabout being fair play. Offensive rebound leading to a 3, and what a poor pass by Anthony Collins.
And a turnover by A&M.
Good.
And a turnover by Kentucky.
Oh, what a play by House.
And look at this burst of speed and the follow by Jones.
Kentucky just didn't get back. It's almost like they were conceding the transition layup.
Only regular season matchup between the Wildcats and the Aggies, and it has been a good one.
Really, this is about right now getting Murray and Ulis inside that line. Just chase them off the line, make them take tough twos. If they make them, more power to them, but you can't give them threes.
Murray way off on the 3.
He had a shot clock problem there. He just had to let that thing fly. But the transition got the steal, and really nobody busted it back.
And yet another offensive rebound, and that time they capitalized. 50-49, A&M leads.
Couple of zippers to get House into the middle of the floor.
It will stay with the Aggies.
Even with all the offensive rebounds that Kentucky's given up, all the second opportunities, they're just down a point on the road.
Russo shovel pass. Trocia Morelos is fouled. Coming your way on Big Monday, 7 o'clock Eastern time, Virginia at Miami. We'll have North Carolina at Virginia on a game day next week from Charlottesville, then into Big 12 country, Iowa State and West Virginia. A couple of matchups involving 2 ranked teams, both games also streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
Boy, Iowa State, West Virginia is going to be a fistfight because both those teams need it. And Monte Morris, one of the best point guards in the country that does not turn the ball over very often, going against a West Virginia press that forces a lot of turnovers.
Impressive road win today for Oklahoma at West Virginia. Buddy Hield pouring in 29. The game was closer than the final score would indicate, 76-62, a very nice win for the Sooners.
Well, you have to think, even with West Virginia's pressure, that if anybody can handle it, it's the trio of guards that Lon Kruger puts out on the floor. And Buddy Hield at 29 in that game. Another terrific performance by the senior.
Bissier trying to back down his man. Lost the ball. Collins hits the deck. And it's out of bounds off him back to Kentucky.
Well, Kentucky keeps the ball. But how about Anthony Collins getting on the floor? Well, first to the floor. Shows who wanted it more. And Anthony Collins wanted that ball more.
Student section at both ends of the court appreciating the effort by the fifth-year senior.
A terrific job by Collins. Both Murray and Ulis working off the ball with Briscoe handling it out front.
Willis corner 3. Good hold off there by Trocia Morelos on LeBissiere to free up the rebound.
Well, Texas A&M was lucky because Jalen Jones came off of Willis in that corner. Can't do that. Good fake.
House the kick. Boy, Collins had Jones for a moment. Didn't hit him with the pass. Now he does. Jones banging into the chest of Willis. Rejected by LeBissiere.
Well, that looked like goaltending. That was awfully high up there. But Jones got away with a walk. That's John Calipari signaling it. That's right. That's for awfully close.
Pretty close.
Awfully close. Yeah.
Isaac Humphries returns for Kentucky. DJ Hogue had a very nice first half for the Aggies is back in. Gilder as well. And now for the first time today, here comes Charles Matthews, a 6'6 freshman from Chicago.
We'll get a little circle action off this. And you think Kentucky's going to switch some of this stuff.
Hey, 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 hey. Shot clock inside five. Caruso. Wow. He's a player.
And he plays at both ends of the floor, doesn't he? Just knows how to play the game.
John Calipari wants a timeout. Alex Caruso with the shot clock running down. Knocks one down for the Aggies. I'm in practice. Well, I don't know if it's going to make perfect in a crazy year like this year where it's so hard to predict anything. Look at what's gone on in the top 10, where five of the 10 teams in the top 10 lost at some point this week.
Well, it's remarkable. It's the usual suspects that are in the top 25. You look at that top 10. It's almost indistinguishable from another year. But they've got like 48 or 50 losses in the top 10. At this point in the season, that's extraordinary to have that many losses among the top teams.
I mean, there have been years where we've had teams still perfect now, or multiple teams with one or two losses.
Right.
We're talking about teams with four and five and six losses being in the top five of the country.
Yeah, it's really amazing. And this year, you know, we're going to go through this bracket practice. It's going to be a ton of fun, but you may be able to throw darts on Selection Sunday and be just as accurate.
4-point lead, A&M. Make it six. Nice feed from Caruso to Trosha Morelos.
You know, that shows that you come off the ball screen, you don't have to go 1,000 miles an hour. You can play with pace, let the play develop, draw the defense to you, and then hit the roll man. That was just beautiful.
Murray with Caruso on him as he's been most of the game.
Caruso's done a fabulous job on a great offensive player. Now the switch. Oh, what a play by Caruso.
Ahead to House. There are 351 Division I programs in this country. 351 coaches would take Caruso in a heartbeat.
Maybe 352.
He does so many things to help his team win.
Got a switch now. Hogue on Ulis. Caruso had a switch, so he got switched off, but still made the read and got back to make that steal. So there's the switch with Trosha Morelos, but he makes the play, and then Trosha Morelos throws it down to House for an easy bucket. What a great play by Alex Caruso.
Welcome back to Reed Arena. Dan Schulman, Jay Billis, and Shannon Spake. A good one here on Saturday primetime. Texas A&M has opened it up a little bit, 59-51 over Kentucky. And as we went into the timeout, Jay's just getting the information from Anthony Jordan, one of the officials. We have a technical foul on the A&M bench.
Yeah, he said Billy Kennedy. It was on Billy Kennedy. He said he was mouthing off to Pat Adams, which I find hard to believe because Billy Kennedy doesn't get much above.
He's a soft-spoken guy.
He's very soft-spoken.
Yeah.
But if that's all it was right there, then I think the official should just walk away. That's really hard to believe because Billy Kennedy's hard to hear.
So Ulis is shooting the two free throws for the technical. Now, what Kennedy must have been upset about was the personal foul call that happened leading into that timeout. So Ulis makes both, and now Ulis gets two more free throws for the personal foul.
Yeah, it's hard for me to understand because Billy Kennedy's as mild-mannered as you can get. And now, look, I don't know what he said, but, you know, officials can pretend not to hear things. And when you don't have guys that are demonstrative and jumping all over the place, I'm not a big fan of that. I think it's how you behave more so than what you say. But I'm a little surprised by that, honestly.
Here's the foul call. We're speculating that this...
There's no question it was a foul.
That must be...
The foul's on Gilder. There's
right.
No question he had two hands on the ball handler. There's no argument there.
But we're speculating that that's what upset Kennedy. It could have been something from further back.
Sure, absolutely. And we don't know what he said. I'm not... Look, maybe what he said deserved a technical foul, but when you have... You know, referees, I think, often call things when they're shown up, quote-unquote shown up. And there was nothing showing up a referee there.
So that's a 4-point trip for Kentucky. Hogue misses the three. Murray down with a rebound. And Kentucky can get even closer.
And that could turn out to be a really big play. That technical foul.
And again, as you've mentioned, the ball in the hands of Briscoe Moore. Murray and Ulis both off the ball. Briscoe misses another jumper.
Not sure that was the shot that John Calipari wanted, but it just gives you two scorers now instead of one. And then you can have Isaiah Briscoe working as a playmaking guard. He has been a point guard in high school, so it's not foreign to him. Really spreading the floor, trying to get ball screen action, then rolls to the basket.
Out there for Jones, and down with the rebound, Ulis.
Texas A&M is settling. They're settling for jump shots instead of attacking the rim and then kicking it out. And right now, the Aggies are a little bit back on their heels.
And no Davis in the game right now for A&M, so more of a perimeter-oriented bunch. Murray comes out from behind the screen. Misses the three. It is tapped into the hands of Caruso.
Well, as great a job as Caruso's done, Murray just finds openings. And he's had to run around so much, you wonder, as you get down to the last 10 minutes of regulation, does he get a little bit tired? Does it get into his legs a little bit? Because he's having to do a lot on defense, too. He's switched off on Jalen Jones right now, and that's where Jones needs to post him. You got to go at offensive, great offensive players and make them guard.
Hogue the drive.
That's a block.
And gotta believe it. No, a charge is the call.
Wow.
So wave off the basket and the foul going against A&M.
Come on, that's terrible. That's just awful.
And the fans saw exactly what you just saw on the video screen.
Well, that's a horrendous call.
He was still sliding?
Still sliding and coming up. He never had legal guarding position to establish. And you know, look, in college, charge calls are given out like Halloween candy on October 31st. And it's not just Tyler Ulis, all that stuff. It has nothing to do with who got it. It's just a constant. The presumption is toward charge instead of the other way around.
Ulis, the jumper, saw a big one at the end of the Duke-Louisville game earlier today.
Which was another horrendous call. And that call that was on Grayson Allen is unjustifiable. And it you know, that one was a lot closer, honestly. But it was still a block. The majority of those are blocks, and they're called as if the majority of them are charges.
Murray hounding Caruso. Turnabout is fair play for the way Caruso has defended Murray today. Shot clock down to 7. Gilder baseline.
Walk. Oh, they tripped him. I thought he walked.
Going to be on Marcus Lee, I believe, and that will be the fourth foul on Lee. Somewhat of a thin Kentucky front court. Alex Poitras missing his fifth game in a row with a right knee injury, and Isaac Humphries is getting ready to check in.
Well, you got to give Kentucky a lot of credit. Their defensive pressure has really taken Texas A&M out of what they want to do. And they've not gotten any clean looks at the basket. They had a nice lead, and the technical foul got Kentucky a little bit closer. But Kentucky's defense much better over the last 7 or 8 possessions.
Let's check in with Shannon.
Well, you know, you mentioned Alex Poitras. With him out, obviously some of the other guys have had an opportunity. Isaac Humphries, who's going in right now, one of those guys. I did check with the team. They still don't have a date on when Poitras will return, but he has been practicing a little bit. Guys, we saw him at shoot-around today out there with the team, so he is being active.
And the knee that is injured now is not the same knee that he suffered the torn ACL in December of 2014.
But he was in practice. He can't move. You can tell. Anytime he puts significant pressure to try to push off that right knee, there's no way he can play right now.
Gilder misses a 3. Loose ball down to Humphries. Derek Willis is down and injured for Kentucky. Briscoe called for the offensive foul, and Willis still down and clutching his right ankle.
Boy, the offensive fouls are coming left and right. All you have to do is fall down.
And Willis not putting any weight at all on that right foot, has been such an important player for Kentucky over the last 10 games or so. And he needs to be helped off the court. Oh, he just rolled it all on his own. Rolled the right ankle just trying to come to a stop. So the depleted front court gets even more depleted. It's now Humphries and Charles Matthews in the game, playing as an undersized 4.
And now they're having to go to a 2-3 zone, it looks like, with Ulis and Briscoe out front. And Jalen Jones is the guy that can be the playmaker in the middle. Good pass there.
House had a good look at a three.
But Jones needs to face up. He can face up and attack. Really effective against Syracuse in the middle of that zone when they were in the Bahamas.
Good rebound by Davis.
Texas A&M needs to run some good offense in the half court. They have settled for a number of shots.
What a pass! And a reverse by Hope. Collins with the assist. That was pretty.
Jamal Murray's got to find a shot here. He can't go this long without scoring.
Got a house on him right now. Matthews from the baseline, air ball. Humphries with a rebound and the putback.
Humphries has come in and made some nice plays. That little short corner jumper several possessions ago, and then that offensive rebound.
Collins keeping the dribble alive. Hogue looks off the defender. And another rebound for Humphries.
They're just not the shot. You know, even though Hogue's a great shooter and terrific shot fake, only one pass and the shot's up. Now Texas A&M spending more time on defense than they were on offense.
Less than 7 minutes to go and a nail biter here in College Station. A&M leading by two.
Now the screen's moving up to the elbows instead of down low. Gives a little more operating room for Murray and Ulis.
Wow. Shot clock running down again. Murray just grazes the rim and it'll be Aggie ball.
I don't get that.
Timeout on the floor. 2-point game.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Texas A&M coming into the season with high hopes. And with good reason. They started the year 17-2, picked up a lot of quality wins, rose up to the program's highest ranking ever, fifth, but then lost five consecutive conference games. They did pick up an out-of-conference win over Iowa State during that stretch. They got healthy with a win over Ole Miss coming into this game, and now they're in a two-pointer here against Kentucky. It has been a big week for Amir Abdur-Rahim, one of the assistants for Texas A&M. He had the scout for this game, which means he's putting in hours and hours and hours of time watching Kentucky tape and doing the scout and leading the way at practice. And his wife gave birth to the couple's first child, baby girl Layla, on Wednesday. He doesn't look sleep deprived, but Shannon, he's got to be sleep deprived, right?
Sleeping on a couch in the hospital room because his family still hasn't come back. He says he's been watching film at night after his wife and obviously his newborn daughter are sleeping. But guys, no rest for the weary because he's got to go right on to Missouri. He says his family will come home tomorrow, but he's already going to start scouting for Missouri this weekend.
All right, Shannon, thank you. 6.5 to go. A&M with the ball and a 2-point lead. Davis trying to back down Humphries and a foul from behind on Charles Matthews. Oh, it's going to be Humphries, forgive me.
Really nice play out of the timeout to get the ball inside to Tyler Davis. And this is a really important game for Texas A&M. Not just for the NCAA tournament and the SEC and all that, just for their confidence level. And one of the reasons that they lost those five straight SEC games was their inability to finish games. That they had some games essentially on their racket where they had an opportunity to finish the game and win it, whether they had Anthony Collins available, whatever the reasons are that you could use for not finishing. This is an opportunity they have to finish in a tight game, in a tough one, that would really give them a confidence boost to where they were before that five-game slide started.
One of two for Davis and a 3-point lead.
And that's the next step for Davis. He's going to get fouled a lot in his career. He's got to become a better free throw shooter. Boy, is he a good player.
Just a freshman. Ulis the drive. Briscoe passed up the jump shot.
Well, everybody had red under their feet there. They were not going to let Isaiah Briscoe into the paint. If he wanted to shoot it, go ahead.
So it'll be Ulis. He is fouled before the shot attempt. The basket will not count.
Ulis lowered that shoulder. I think that's what the crowd is reacting to. Collins trying to maintain position. I don't know, you know, look, I think those are blocks. I think every charge they've called is a block, but that's no different than any of the others they called a charge.
Still not the bonus. Sixth team foul committed by A&M. So a fresh 30 now for Kentucky.
Daniel House on Jamal Murray. A little more size on him.
Caruso not in the game at the moment for the Aggies.
Two big guys, Lee and Humphreys, in for Kentucky.
Briscoe gets inside and scores.
Well, he's just amazing around the bucket. That was with the left hand. And even though he is not a shooter and you're playing him as a driver, he still finds a way to get to the rim.
Got 1-3 and 4 buckets in the paint in this game. Collins with a floater, no.
It looked like Davis got hit as he was trying to come down with that rebound.
And Kentucky can take the lead.
This is where you got to get key stops to beat a terrific team. Not a good switch here. Ulis much quicker than Hogue.
Briscoe, offensive foul.
It's funny, like if the referees were looking at each other like, you call it, no, you call it, no, you call it. They hesitated before they call it. And
sarcastic applause right there, absolutely.
Like, look, that I think was a charge.
I agree.
But, you know, because Collins is in terrific position and Briscoe just threw his shoulder into his chest. But, I mean, call it right away. There's no reason to hesitate. They were looking at each other like, you want to call this? I blew the whistle, so we got to call something.
Jones is fouled and will head to the free throw line. Don't forget, coming up on ABC tonight, great NBA action. Chris Paul, the 9-time All-Star, leads the LA Clippers against the Golden State Warriors. The Warriors trying to bounce back from a 32-point loss to Portland last night. That foul was on Isaiah Briscoe. That's his fourth. So Lee has 4 and Briscoe has 4.
Jalen Jones coming off a game against Ole Miss. He was 3 of 11, had only 6 points. He had 21 points against Alabama before that. And a guy who's averaging just under 16 a game. But boy, what a super athletic, explosive player. He can guard. He's good in transition. Boy, the free throw line's really let Texas A&M down in this one.
7 for 14.
And that's the kind of thing. It's been one thing or another. You know, they haven't done a good job on the glass, or you know, they let South Carolina knock in 12 threes against them, didn't finish the game against LSU. A&M's done a much better job in the second half of chasing Kentucky off the three-point line. Everything's been tough twos. Now getting down to another late clock.
Ulis having to create. Bounce pass to Lee. Got to get a shot off, and he did not in time.
It's the lack of awareness. Nobody's moving. John Calipari's moving. Well, he's upset and should be. It's a poor offensive possession by Kentucky.
Dominique Hawkins in for Isaiah Briscoe.
And while it's been a struggle in the second half offensively for the Wildcats, they haven't gotten anything in transition back into the 2-3 zone now in the half court. You got to give Texas A&M credit. Their defense has been really good. House has done a nice job when he's been on Jamal Murray. Murray has been very quiet in this second half.
House. Davis into Jones, tipped away. Ball is loose. Ulis has it. And it'll be a held ball as Davis got a hand in there. The arrow will give it to Kentucky when we come back from this media timeout. 63-61. Unranked A&M trying to beat Kentucky. Jay Will today said Aggies will win. We'll see if he's right. The next 3:49. That Purdue, Indiana here on ESPN, the Warriors and the Clippers over on ABC, but we've still got 3:49 to go here in College Station. Dan Schulman, Jay Billis, Shannon Spake, Kentucky and Texas A&M with the Aggies leading by 2.
Caruso back on Murray. House did a really good job on him.
House on Hawkins right now. Briscoe is on the bench. If you weren't with us earlier, Derek Willis rolled his ankle, has not returned for Kentucky.
Another switch.
And Euless turned it over.
Well, that's seven turnovers now in the second half for Kentucky. They've got nothing in transition, only one three-pointer in the second half, and seven turnovers.
How about the deep position and the nice little jump hook for Tyler Davis?
Well, Davis is just a load down there. He ran rim to rim, and they couldn't push him out of that spot. Boy, Jamal Murray cannot find any opening. Caruso staying right with him.
It's free for a moment, and he knocks it down to make it a one-point game.
Doesn't need much room, does he? What a player.
15 for Murray.
And he's had to work for everything. Jamal Murray gets nothing easy. 2-3 zone. Jalen Jones needs to get in the middle of that zone, make a play.
Caruso will make a play.
And I think that Lee got a finger on that ball. That was a finger roll of a different kind.
The lead back to three. 2:20 to go.
Going with their zipper set, which in the NBA they would call a floppy set.
Trying to get Murray free again. Couple of screens by Humphreys. Can't get him free. Now he'll drive it and draw the foul. And it is a bonus situation for Kentucky.
Well, Murray, when he's gone from side to side, when he looks like he's going to come out the left side and he goes all the way around, Humphreys just gave a little bump to Caruso. Then he's got to get around Marcus Lee. And that was just enough time. I'll bet you Murray's run like a half marathon in this thing. He gets to put a little sticker on his car, 13.5. He has logged a ton of miles in this thing.
Well, reminiscent of a guy like a Ray Allen, a J.J. Redick at various levels, and all the running they would do to get free for their shots.
It's reminded me kind of Reggie Miller, the way he had to get open under the basket, try to get your guy on one side and then rub him off and come off a little screen. And he's always ready to shoot. As a catch and shoot guard, he is devastating.
Humphreys will sit Labissiere back into the game.
And Tyler Davis, if Labissiere is guarding him, he can lock him down into a spot and go right into him.
See if Labissiere has him or Lee. Labissiere's on him right now, and A&M will use a timeout.
Yeah, I think Billy Kennedy wants to go right inside to Tyler Davis like he did out of the last timeout.
1-point lead, 2 minutes to go. Let's take a look at the best of both worlds brought to you by Cheez-It. And the best of both worlds for A&M in this game has been the offensive rebound.
Well, especially in the first half. 20 points in this ball game off offensive rebounds. I think it's 19 overall. There's 15 in the first half. And Kentucky's first shot defense hadn't been bad, but, well, I'll tell you what, they have gotten a lot of second chance opportunities. And they do want to go to Davis inside.
And he's got Labissiere on him.
Walk.
No, a foul call against Labissiere.
Well, that was a smart play by Billy Kennedy. He knew after the timeout, especially since he'd gone to him earlier, that he was going to try to exploit that matchup. And it puts Tyler Davis back at the line, where he's not been particularly proficient at this game, but he's got two shots now going right, just right into the chest of Labissiere. I thought he shuffled his feet first.
4 for 8 tonight, 64% on the season.
This young man puts in a ton of work, an absolute ton of work. They got to kick him out of the gym.
One of two, 2-point game.
And the free throw line would have given this Texas A&M team some separation, but they haven't been able to knock him down.
Barely 500. Barely 50%, 9 for 17 on the game. Murray, Briscoe, and Lee is called for the walk. Lee doesn't like it. Calipari doesn't like it.
Well, he's talking about the walk on the other end. You know, why didn't you call the walk on the other end, which is a standard coach's lament. Big possession right here defensively for Kentucky on the road. Can you get a stop? And you got to think that Texas A&M should look inside again to Davis.
Still with Labissiere on. Collins. Ulis with a blocked shot.
What a bad possession. Great play by Ulis, but a bad possession by Texas A&M. No movement and just going right into the defense.
And a timeout taken by Kentucky with 50 seconds to go.
Like, how about that play by Ulis? Going against another point guard, staying in front of him. I think he was looking for a screen. You see him turning his head looking for a ball screen. And that was all leather up top. What a great play. Not known as a shot blocker.
His fourth of the season, he'll have you know, Jay. Let's check in with Shannon Spink.
Well, Dan, you know, Coach Calipari's been talking a lot about defense lately, and I was at practice last week. He said to his guys, who is going to be the player to step up and win the game defensively? If they are able to go on to a victory, you know he will look to that play by Tyler Ulis.
Shannon, thank you. A reminder about Big Monday, great doubleheader. You'll see four ranked teams. It'll start with Virginia and Miami at 7 o'clock Eastern. Then Iowa State and West Virginia for Morgantown at 9 o'clock Eastern. Both games also streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. Well, this has been all we could have hoped for. It was Kentucky by one at halftime. It's A&M by two right now. If Kentucky wins, they open up a little bit of separation in the SEC. If A&M wins, then it is really, really tight. A&M would be 9-5. Same as South Carolina after their win today. Same as LSU after their loss today. And Kentucky would drop back to 10-4. So an A&M win would put four teams within one game.
And right now for Kentucky, Dan, remember, Derek Willis has been out of the game with that sprained ankle. So that means that there's one less perimeter shooting threat on the floor. Texas A&M can really pack the paint here. The guys they've got to be primarily concerned about are Tyler Ulis and Jamal Murray. And Kansas with this lineup went to a triangle and two.
Humphreys back in for Labissiere. Just two shooters in the game for the Wildcats. The lob to Lee, and it's tied.
But what a great play out of the timeout. Run by Kentucky.
10th assist of the game for Tyler Ulis.
Just a little back screen and a screen for the screener, and nobody went on that little down screen by Marcus Lee. Everybody worried about Ulis. And nobody looking for Lee. Not enough pressure on the ball to take away vision. Really well executed. Now we got a timeout with 42 seconds to go in regulation. Now it comes down to what Shannon Spake was just talking about. Can Kentucky on the road get a stop?
And the referees are apparently, the officials apparently looking at the clock right now. I don't know if it ran when it shouldn't have after the bucket.
Yeah, maybe it did a little bit, a couple seconds. Be around 42. Or 44, excuse me.
So 43-9, it looks like, is what they'll go back to. Von Miller's liking it. Super Bowl MVP, former Aggie in the house.
Now, is he taking pictures or selfies? Is he trying to get in Admon Gilder's territory?
When you're the MVP of the Super Bowl, you can do anything you want. Lee and the Cats are fired up after the feed from Ulis to Tyre. Now Humphreys is back in the game. Do you still go right back inside to Davis? What are you looking for from the Aggies?
Well, I think some ball screen action and moving the ball from side to side. There's plenty of time right here for Texas A&M to get the shot that they want. But we'll see what Kentucky does. Looks like they're in man-to-man.
Hand off to House. All kinds of contesting by the defense. And a foul is the call going against A&M.
Against Tyler Davis. It looks like it. He just went right over the top on that rebound. And it looked like he went over Marcus Lee. So that puts a poor free throw shooter on the line. And Marcus Lee shooting only 37%. He's 16 of 43 from the line.
Well, that was a good defensive stand there by Kentucky. They had three defenders around Tyler Davis.
You know, and House wasn't as strong on the drive as you would usually expect him to be. Kind of got knocked back with the chest-to-chest contact.
1-1 for Lee, who, as Jay mentioned, is a poor free throw shooter. And they're trying to mess with him here.
Free throw blockouts become a really big deal now for Texas A&M.
In and out, rebound Davis. A 1 second difference basically between the game clock and the shot clock.
Gonna get a timeout here.
And they will take it with 22.6 seconds to go. Last year in this building, a double overtime thriller that stood out as Kentucky's closest call during their undefeated regular season run. The Aggies were without Jalen Jones. Daniel House led the way with 25 for A&M. Tyler Ulis puts Kentucky ahead with a three-pointer in double overtime, his first points of the game, and Kentucky would win 70-64.
Well, Texas A&M can basically take the entire clock here, and you want to get a shot up with enough time for an offensive rebound, because Texas A&M has done such a good job overall in the offensive glass. Give yourself a little bit of time for a second shot, but not enough time for Kentucky to take it the other way.
Coming up after us, Purdue and Indiana here on ESPN, and after that, don't miss SportsCenter at night with John Abuchagras and John Anderson. They'll have all the highlights from around college basketball, the NBA, spring training, and an update from Daytona. Also streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
Well, Texas A&M's got the ball. They've also got the arrow, and that's important should there be a tie-up.
And they've got two free throws on any common foul.
And it's important too, Dan. They've got a timeout. If you can't get the ball inbounds here, you've got a timeout. You don't want to use it, but you can. And if you don't get what you want midway through the shot clock, you can call that timeout.
What has Billy Kennedy drawn up? What kind of a look is he hoping for as Collins gets ready to inbound it?
Well, they've had some success in running some ball screen action. They've also been able to, out of timeouts, they've looked inside, but you know they're not going to want to attack right away. There's just too much time. If you get a layup, you want to take it.
Caruso to handle it.
Caruso being guarded by Lee out front. So Lee's going to be able to just take his time and then start with about 9 seconds left on the clock. He's waiting too long.
Ulis comes as if he's going to trap. Caruso the kick to House. 5 seconds. House elevates. Left it short. Ulis has it with 1 second left. And we are going to overtime. A decent look for House on about a 16-foot jump shot, but he left it on the front of the rim.
Right now, John Calipari saying, look, my team called the timeout. And you're pretending you didn't see it. Well, the referees just didn't see it. But that's what he's telling them. Tell him to go look at it. He can't look at it. It's a judgment call.
So we will head to overtime here at Reed Arena.
Boy, and when you look back on this, maybe not the best shot that Texas A&M could have gotten. Fading away for Daniel House. And a good job by Jamal Murray just putting late pressure on the shot. But you have to look back to the free throw line. Murray's calling time. Looked like he might have been clapping too. You can see the referee not seeing that. They should be in tune with it. You've got to look for that. But that should have been Tyler Ulis calling that thing.
Yeah, Murray's calling timeout, not looking at the official who was right over his right shoulder. Didn't know he was there as he was doing it.
Yeah, you can see the officials missing that.
So we're heading to overtime. A&M just 9 of 17, you talked about it, Jay, on the free throw line in this game.
Yeah, that's what they're going to look back on. You know, from the Texas A&M perspective, there are always two perspectives to this. The Aggies have to be looking at this, that we should not be in overtime because we missed a bunch of free throws. And I'm sure Kentucky's perspective, how many more offensive rebounds? We shouldn't be in overtime either. We gave up a ton of offensive rebounds. We turned the ball over in the second half, all that stuff. But it's about looking forward now. There's 5 minutes of play in this overtime period. And the team that's really the team that does the tougher stuff, that blocks out, that gets second shots, that doesn't turn the ball over, that gets the shot that they want, is going to come out a victor.
Some confusion as the teams lined up on the wrong side of the court.
Haven't been in overtime in a while. You change at halftime, but that's it. Once halftime's over, you say that.
All 10 players were under a false assumption. The officials had to straighten them out. Purdue and Indiana will start momentarily over on ESPN News as we take you into overtime here at Reed Arena in College Station with Jay Billis, Shannon Spake. I'm Dan Schulman of Kentucky, and A&M tied up at 68. Jones muscling his way inside.
Boy, just got Isaiah Briscoe down in the post, faced up and just bullied into the bucket.
They had that matchup on the last possession too, but didn't go for a look to Jones. Went right to him to start overtime.
Well, Hornsett using Murray as a screener, that got him wide open,
and he knocks down his fourth three of the game.
Boy, that was a terrific play by Kentucky. Back screen by Jamal Murray. Then he pops out for the three. Just confusion defensively for Texas A&M.
Murray's now made 25 threes in his last five games.
What a switch now. That means Ulis is on Jones. Jones needs to take him down to the post. There he is.
Russo lobbing it inside, and the pass hit the rim, but the foul is called on Ulis.
Now take a look at this play by Jamal Murray. So that's a little back pick. He's going to set the back pick here, and then he's going to get out to the three-point line, and there was just confusion on the switch. So picked up, and then Caruso thought Jalen Jones was going to stay with him, and it wound up being a wide open three for Jamal Murray.
A really smart play by Jalen Jones to post Tyler Ulis when he got that switch.
Free throw frustration is mounting for the Aggies.
Missed them both. Wow.
It's a 76% shooter.
And you feel a little air going out of the building when he missed that one.
A vocal minority here in College Station. Kentucky fans, many of them on their feet right now.
The box set.
Murray.
He got hit.
Caruso called for the foul.
Got hit twice, actually. Got hit the first time he went up, and then again.
Murray doesn't show a lot of emotion out there, but he was upset about what you were just talking about. He thinks he's getting fouled on a regular basis.
Well, there's no question he got fouled here. Obviously, he feels he got hit before that because he saw the frustration. But that was two fouls in one. Yeah, they didn't call the first one and just got the second one. But actually, if Caruso hadn't fouled him the second time, I don't think they would have called that first one. Which is, you know, kind of mind-boggling with the way referees hand out charges that they don't protect shooters better.
Murray is 77% shooter. His first miss from the line tonight. He's 4 for 5.
Well, the way Kentucky has rebounded the ball and all the second shots they've given up, it's kind of remarkable they've got the lead, really. You got to give them a lot of credit for being as gutsy as they've been on the road, because it has not been a friendly place to the Wildcats. Certainly not as friendly as Rupp Arena's been. They're unbeaten in Rupp, but they've lost their games away from home,
including their only overtime game of the season, a loss at Kansas in overtime a few weeks back. Humphreys with a rebound in traffic.
What a heck of a rebound by Humphreys. And that was another possession, Dan, where I thought Texas A&M settled. Yeah, that was a shot they can get almost any time they want. They didn't put any pressure on the Kentucky defense.
Murray. Rebound House.
Hey, Murray still, it's amazing with all the running he's done. He still looks fresh.
Jones over Lee.
Lee was just walking into him. And that's five on Marcus Lee. Just walked right into him, kept his hands up, but kept going into him. And that's it for Lee, isn't it?
Yep. Five on Lee and a chance for three for Jones.
Now watch Lee just keep walking right in. That's clear foul, even though his hands were up. And Jones kept his eyes up. Your eyes make layups for you. And he finished a tough play over a pretty darn good shot blocker in Marcus Lee.
And we've seen this before when it's a really serious moment in a game. John Calipari will often go to a player that he trusts a lot, and that's Dominique Hawkins. But he is going to an incredibly small lineup right now. It's Humphreys and four guards in the game for Kentucky.
Not a lot of options.
He is opting not to go to Matthews, not to go to LeBissiere. Willis is injured, hurt his ankle, has not returned. So guys like House and Jones are going to have significant size advantages over whoever's guarding.
And this is where it's very difficult for Kentucky not having Derek Willis available.
Yep.
When he twisted that ankle, it took out an experienced player, an older player, and then a better offensive player that can stretch the floor. They've done this with the floor shrunk and everybody trying to pack the paint on him. A&M needs to guard that three-point line. Everything should be chased off of that.
Murray gets free. Jones the rebound. Let's see how Kentucky matches up. Let's see if A&M tries to find a mismatch and take advantage.
I'd go into Tyler Davis.
And Caruso's pass is knocked away.
And Kentucky not getting anything in transition. It's been a rough night in the full court. Everything's had to come in the half court.
Briscoe the jumper. Humphreys is fouled by
Caruso.
Caruso, I think, reaching in. You're right.
What great block up top, but Caruso got him on the arm as he was going up. Just a little tick on the arm. And that was enough to send Humphreys to the free throw line.
Humphreys has been a significant contributor for Kentucky in this game.
Well, just the minutes he's been able to play, the big body in the paint, he's grabbed some rebounds, finished a couple plays. That little short corner jumper was important.
Got 10 rebounds. And got a lucky bounce there to tie the game.
Lucky, that's a shooter's bounce.
In some circles, they call that a Billis bounce.
Well, if he was Canadian, it would have been a shooter's bounce.
That one is clean, and Kentucky leads. House has Murray on him. Jones has Briscoe on him. We saw that matchup payoff for A&M in the overtime. House on the drive draws the foul.
House got the switch, and it was Humphreys on him. He just drove it.
Back to the studio quickly, Doug Kazarian.
All right, Dan, thank you very much. As you mentioned at the beginning of overtime, Purdue and Indiana starting over on ESPN News. It will continue right here on ESPN, assuming things ever end here at College Station. Dan and Jay.
All right, Doug, thank you. A&M down by one. House at the line. House a 68% free throw shooter on the season.
Daniel House has had eight straight double-figure games coming into this one at 20 against LSU. But that streak is in jeopardy.
A&M on top. Brown on its feet.
Ulis working off the ball with Collins on him. And Caruso still chasing around Murray. Those two have got to be exhausted.
Shot clock at six. Floater by Ulis. Got it.
He is unbelievable.
Yep.
What a great shot.
22 for Tyler Ulis.
He does it. He looks like he just woke up. You know, does he sweat? I don't think he sweats.
And they played less than 48 hours ago. They played Thursday night against Tennessee.
What an unbelievable player. Just got great poise, directing traffic, gets right past, goes right over a big man with that little floater. You know, when he comes to a 2-footed stop, He's just so hard to deal with. You don't know whether he's going to come to that stop and make a play down low or whether he's going to launch a little floater up high.
11 assists to go with those 22 points. And to revisit a conversation we had in the first half, you said if you had a vote and the vote was today, Ulis is your SEC player of the year?
Yeah, because he wins. I mean, his team's at the top of the SEC. I think you're handing out player of the year awards. It doesn't always go to the guy you think's the best player. I mean, look, Ben Simmons, LSU, is going to be the number one pick in the draft. Long term, you know, he's the better player. But right now, Tyler Ulis is the bigger winner. And he makes everybody around him better. So does Ben Simmons. He makes his teammates better. But this young man can score. He can dish it. He's a very good defender.
Rarely comes out of the game.
He never. You can't take him out.
Yeah.
You should lose your coaching license if you take him out of the game. You know, he's right up there with anybody as a point guard this year. I mean, I tend to favor overall Chris Dunn of Providence. But heck, you're talking about two of the best in the game. And Dunn's going to be a higher draft pick, and you know he fits the suit in the NBA. And he scores at a higher rate, he rebounds at a higher rate, the assists are about the same, and his shooting numbers are better, and he's a better defender. His steals are double those of Ulis, but you're not going to find a better floor general, floor leader than Tyler Ulis.
One minute to go in overtime. A&M down by one. A&M starting the year 7-0 in conference play. They're now 8-5. They can move within a game of the lead in the SEC with a win in this one. Kentucky gets a little separation from the crowd if they win it. One of the Kentucky fans' favorite stats is they've won more SEC regular season championships than all other schools put together. And if you're a fan of Kentucky, you can understand why you like that stat. That's pretty impressive.
That's incredible, really. And it's equally incredible they're atop the SEC again.
Lob inside. Jones left it short. Humphries rips it down. Boy, Jones had a good look, and he knows it. He's upset.
Well, he's just off balance, and I don't know whether he thought he got a bump. Doesn't matter. Brisco fought him down on that low post, and it was a well-designed play. But that's the point about finishing.
Shot clock inside 10. The ball screen for Ulis. Blocked by Collins. Kentucky ball with four to shoot.
There's a little hammer action being run on the right side. A little back pick for Jamal Murray to get him open in the corner. But just a spectacular play defensively.
And John Calipari will use the timeout.
You can see the little back pick run. Briscoe setting it. And I think Murray would have been open, but Ulis went up for that shot. And Collins just came out of nowhere to get that with his left hand. And now 4 seconds left on the shot clock.
Kentucky with the ball and the lead, 23 seconds to go in overtime, trying to make it a 5-game winning streak. They have had to earn this one. A&M did not shoot free throws well. That helped Kentucky's cause. Kentucky was obliterated on the glass in the first half. But still, they've got the lead in overtime and a chance to open up a 2-game lead in the conference with a win today.
Whatever you do, you cannot leave Jamal Murray here.
Murray gets inside, can't finish. Aggies ball, shot clock turned off. They've got a timeout. Doesn't look like they're going to use it. Collins had it knocked away. Humphries has it and a foul.
Well, the second time late that Collins took the ball into traffic. Humphries just threw the ball down. And are they teeing him up for that? They can't be.
They did.
They teed him up
they
for
teed
that.
Up Humphries.
Wow. Well, we have officially gone into Little League.
And it's his fifth. Technical counts as a personal.
He spiked the ball after, but it's after they made the play. So he wasn't doing it in anger. He was happy. I mean, that's just, look, I get it, but come on. They're officially in Little League.
Now, Humphreys is supposed to be shooting free throws down here.
Yeah, and that'll happen. They'll shoot the technical free throws first. So Texas A&M will get the technical free throws.
Yeah.
And then Humphreys will go down and shoot.
Humphreys is fouled out. That's his fifth.
That's right.
He's out.
That'll be interesting. Yeah. So Billy Kennedy probably gets to choose. I've never seen this before. That's about as bizarre a situation as you're going to see. So if he's unavailable to shoot, I don't think John Calipari can pick. I think it's got to be Billy Kennedy that gets to choose, which I've always thought was a ridiculous thing to let the opposing coach choose anything. This will be an interesting explanation because I've never encountered this in all my years of basketball seeing this.
And you can see as soon as Humphreys threw the ball, Euless starts pleading with the official right away, almost as if sensing the technical is coming.
Look, the technical foul is justified. I understand it. I just think you look the other way on that. It wasn't done in anger at a call or anything. There's emotion in this game, and the emotion was shown. He wasn't trying to show anybody up. See, look, they're, you know, just happy about a play being made. And then he realized right away.
And right away, yeah, you can see.
Now, if he had caught it, what would the difference have been? What if he had thrown it down and caught it? Now, look, I'm not blaming the officials. I get it. They have to do it.
By the letter of the law.
Yeah, the letter of the law. But you know what? They wouldn't have been fired if they didn't call it. And they would have justified if we would have said, oh, it should have been a technical. They would have said, no, come on now. So whatever way they called it, they would have tried to justify it.
I believe Billy Kennedy chooses the Kentucky free throw shooter amongst the other players on the floor. I don't think it's anybody on the bench. I think it's on the floor.
Which makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
But it's just a bizarre.
Yeah.
It's just a bizarre scenario.
Right.
And it's really an interesting rule because I just don't find it appropriate the other coach gets to choose.
Jerry Pollard, one of the officials, coming over to tell Jay what's going on. So who's shooting? The sub who comes into the game?
His sub shoot. The referee says his sub shoots the free throw. Don't confuse it with the injury.
Okay.
The injury one where the opposing coach chooses. So John Calipari gets to choose who shoots the free throw.
Whoever he puts in the game.
So you'll see the technical free throws first, and then the point of it. You know, this one I knew. The point of interruption. So then they'll go down and shoot the two free throws that Humphreys was to take, but now it'll be whoever John Calipari
puts in. I think Charles Matthews checked in, or is it LeBissiere? No, LeBissiere checked into the game.
So LeBissiere comes in, the better shooter, and he shoots the free throws. Just a bizarre situation.
Yeah. House makes two huge free throws to give A&M the lead. And now Scott LeBissiere off the bench and right to the free throw line. So this is different than if a foul incapacitated a player by injury.
Yes, that was the injury rule.
This technical foul disqualified a player.
But I've never seen that before, where a player who's fouled gets his fifth foul while he gets getting a technical after he got fouled. It's just a really bizarre situation.
LeBissiere, one of two. A&M with a chance to win it at the end of overtime, and a timeout is called with 4.1 seconds to go.
And the ball looks like it'll be inbounded right in front of us. And that can be a difficult inbound.
Yeah. Well, A&M has had a couple of chances to put this game away. They did not have a good possession at the end of regulation. What do you think they're going to try to do here at the end of overtime?
Well, you don't have a lot of time here. It's only 4 seconds, so you get it in. You can certainly drive it and try to get something going toward the basket. But I think you look toward either opportunities to look toward the corner to run something to get in the corner because that's the easiest angle for a pass or something near the top of the key.
You wonder if they'll try to pick on that matchup that they've gone to a couple of times. If Briscoe is on Jones again, do they try to get Jones a look because of the size of him?
Well, you can, but that's kind of my point is there's not a ton of time to try to get somebody in the post. You've got to catch you know, there's time for a shot fake and a drive, and I think a shot fake can be very effective right here to free up. But what you have to do is every cutter's got to wait for the screen to be set before you come off the with the cut.
Arrow belongs to Kentucky. Tie game, 4 seconds in overtime. Caruso will inbound it for A&M.
Well, I'd put Scalabiciere on the ball.
Hawkins on the ball, Labiciere on Davis.
That's not a lot of size on the ball.
And it is Briscoe on House. Again, Kentucky giving up a lot of size here. And John Calipari has one timeout left here in overtime, so he'll use it.
Right now for Kentucky, this is all about defense. You're trying to get to another overtime. And so putting in your best defensive lineup, and that would include, for me, size on the ball.
He is so shorthanded right now. Lee has fouled out. Humphreys has fouled out. Poitras is injured. Willis was injured in this game. So in terms of who he has on the floor, he's got very little choice right now. But in terms of who he has on the ball, you make a great point.
An over-exuberant Isaac Humphreys.
Wow.
With that technical foul. What a big play that's turned out to be. And you feel for that young man because he didn't mean anything by it. It wasn't like he was lashing out at an official.
You
hate to go back to that, but you do wonder, what if he'd slammed the ball down and he caught it? Would that be any different in character? I don't think so, and I don't think the referees would have called that a technical. And that didn't seem unsporting to me, but got to play it out. There's the corner.
House forces it up. Follow, yes! Will it count?
It will.
They're going to check. The officials are trying to keep the floor clear to make sure the basket was scored before time expired.
It was out of Davis's hand to my eye before you saw the red light around the bucket.
And fitting, if A&M is to win it, that it's an offensive rebound that wins it for them.
Well, as we thought, they got the ball into the corner. A lot of contact, but he got it off in plenty of time.
Yep.
Kentucky knew it. They were shaking hands right away.
Now the two teams are already lined up. The handshakes are going on, and A&M, we'll wait for the official word, but it appears to be all but official right now. They win it in overtime, 79-77. Tyler Davis with the putback, one of his 9 offensive rebounds. There's the official word. A&M knocks off Kentucky to tighten things up in the SEC.
Right, that was the kind of win that Texas A&M needed, not just for the conference race or NCAA tournament seeding, but that's what I would term a mental health win. You win a game like this and your confidence can soar.
And Isaac Humphreys can only imagine what he's feeling after that technical foul, in effect, led to the conclusion of this game. Boy, what an evening. What a game.
Well, oftentimes it's not the initial shot, it's the second shot. And Tyler Davis, on a night where offensive rebounds did in Kentucky, that was the last nail.
Von Miller loves it. Everybody loves it here at Reed Arena as A&M beats Kentucky in overtime. Purdue, Indiana, Bob Wischus and Dan Dockage, take it away.